Greetings everyone, this is Er from Plecter Labs, and I wanted to showcase this saber, which is a Evolution Arm Vader's Vault hilt, and it's equipped with LED strip type of connector from TCSS, and I wanted to review some of the aspects of the new board, especially since it's been discussed quite a lot on social media. And I haven't been demonstrating anything yet because I wanted to finalize certain aspects of the code. So, first thing, we're going to attempt to start the saber.
Primary crystal missing.
And as you can see, you have a bunch of things happening. You have
primary crystal missing.
The LED, which seems to be talking to you. So the accent LEDs have audio feedback, audio flicker activated on this one. And we're using the TCSS connector as well to detect the presence of the blade. So it's prevented to start the saber if we don't have the blade. So I'm going to insert the blade now. Now we get the sound, we get the flicker feedback for the audio as well when we insert the blade. And now we can start the saber. I will demonstrate smooth swing later, because obviously this is not very easy to swing on the table. So what happens when we pull the blade out? We get another sound indicating that you cannot start the saber.
Primary crystal missing. Primary crystal missing.
So I'm going to use the blade plug for now, which will be easier to demonstrate. Insert the blade plug and secure it with the key. There you go, it remains inside. Now we can power up the saber. So the font currently playing is The Balance, I think. So there you go, you have this first basic interaction with the blade detection that prevents the saber from being ignited. This is of course configurable, and this is part of the tangible font selection system, which has been extended and improved in version 10. Now we have much more slots. We have a total of 16 slots in the tangible selection. So you can have up to 16 actions that allow for changing fonts, but eventually changing profiles or colors as well, based on what accessory you plug into the tangible detection. For now, I only have the tangible system configured for blade in and blade out. So basically the accessory that goes in the chain, the minimum accessory that has to go in the chain is the blade plug, so that it makes the tangible circuit going back to the board so that it can be evaluated. And if you remove it, you move to the first slot, the last slot of tangible, which is basically preventing the saber from being started. There are actually two configurations for the blade removal. One is just doing nothing if the saber is already ignited, so that prevents from having a blade retraction and power off scheme issued because you have a contact loss between the blade and the saber, which can happen during a duel even if the pogo pin system is very reliable. So you don't want in a dueling saber to have this happening. But if you still want to have fun with your saber and demonstrating it, you can still have the tangible working. If the saber is off and the blade is not inserted, then you get the effect that I've just shown before, and you get the primary crystal missing, which is the default sound file, which is hosted on the SD card. So As in the previous versions, basically everything is on the SD card, including those user interface files. So you can basically replace them with, I don't know, C3PO or Darth Vader stating something when you don't have the blade inserted or when you remove it. So I'm just going maybe to show that what happens when you remove the blade and the saber has been ignited. So I'm going to start it. You have the color and it issues in this case, as I was explaining, a blade retraction, and just before the small electric zap sound that indicates that you got a sort of power crystal rupture or something like this. This sound is also configurable, of course. So for the next part of the demo, I'm going to put the blade back so that I can show a little bit about the color setups. There we are. So around the saber, we still have the two types of color changing systems that were present in the previous crystal focus. We have the profile fading, which is basically either a combination action on auxiliary and activator, or it can be auxiliary and a rotation of the hilt, which is what I've configured on that board and what I'm going to show right now. So the new thing is that you can do some color fading plus or minus, so you can move to the next profile or to the previous profile, depending on which direction you're doing the move. Going to cyan. Well, that was aqua. This is cyan, I think. Moving to blue and reaching purple, pink, crimson, I think. And finally, we're back to red. Yeah, red. So we have red here. We have orange. Go back to red. Go back to magenta. And so forth. So the other system is the spectrum color selection system. And basically, to engage it here, I've configured it to be on the two switches. So basically, I'm going to do just a combination action auxiliary first, then followed by the activator. And then I have the click sound that, with the angle of the board, allow you to select the color profile you want. And for instance, select a sort of blue and validate. And there you go. So now, actually, the spectrum selection has two levels. The first level is what most people are using most of the time, which is the color selection. So it has exactly the same idea as in the previous board. Basically, you enter the menu and you select your color by either the angle, that will be the tilt angle, or the roll angle of the hilt, depending on which axis you've selected in the configuration. From there, you can either quit with a short press on an activator and leave the spectrum selection, and your color is selected. It will be saved on the saver as soon as you press the activator to retract the blade and do a power off, and it will be saved on the board to remember which profile you were using last time. You have a second level that allows you to select a blade profile. So I'm going to demonstrate that right now. I'm going to get into the color selection. I'm going to either select a new color or keep the same, and then I'm going to select a blade profile. So there we go. So I can select the color. Let's take a pinkish color, for instance. I do a long press, and now I'm in blade section. So you can see that I'm still in a blade profile that has the pulsing enabled. And I'm going to move to another one, and this one has just a blade with flicker. I can come back to the one that is pulsing, and I can either select this one or come back to this profile. Going to select this one. I'm now back to the color selection, and I can eventually change my mind and decide to do, for instance, this color. And finally escape from the menu, and now I have a non-pulsing blade with just the flicker enabled. And that will be remembered for next time. Alright. So those blade profiles are stored on the SD card, of course. They are stored actually in the main configuration file that hosts all the basic settings that are not profile related. Everything that goes with your motion sensing, the deep sleep behavior or the sleep behavior of the saber, the debug port that you are using for logging messages if you are in debug mode, and those things are stored in config.txt. And you have, following those general settings, all the blade profiles, and you can have up to 16 profiles, blade profiles. So in the blade profile, basically you have everything that is specific to the profile except color, and color is handled by a color profile. This way, you can have different types of blade effects in terms of flicker, unstable effects, pulse or magic activation, or wake up parameter, and anything basically that you want to configure per bank or per profile, you can put it in the blade profile. On the other hand, you have all the colors defined in colors.txt, and basically this way we save us from having a very complicated combinatory explosion of combining a specific profile with a specific color, and we have the two handled separately in different profiles. So basically for a selected blade profile, you still have access to all the colors that you have on the SD card, and you can select one of each. So the next thing that I wanted to show is about the OLED screen. OLED screen, sorry. I'm going to put the blade plug back for something easier for the demo before I get into this, so that the saber can be activated and use all the features. So I've managed to put a small OLED in that saber to do the proper demonstration. Right now we have a screensaver. The screensaver is actually fully configurable, and basically everything you're going to see on the OLED is configurable, except for a bunch of strings that are fixed in the firmware. For instance, the version number, obviously you don't want to be able to change that in the configuration file. Everything is configurable and from the SD card. So those drawings, basically, with the small R2, Enzo did a wonderful job on those, are configurable, and you can change them. Basically, even if you cannot change the scenario of the screensaver, you can at least touch up the bitmaps and change them. So we're going to wake up R2 to move to the next part of the demo. And let's watch him go for a walk. End of the trip for R2. Let's reboot the board to see what we have to offer on the display as well. So you get a nice scrolling effect if the picture that you want to display is larger. It's automatically handled, and basically you can have this on the SD card as well and customize it to your own logo or boot screen, whatever. We also have the option to show the board name and version during a short time, that time being configurable on the SD card as well. It's not just displayed right there, but we're going to see how it looks by going into the vocal menu.
Sound bank selection.
So we have a bunch of animated pictures. Basically, you can have either those animated or regular static for each font. Those are stored in the font directory and
read the fucking manual.
Light.
Bungie.
Legacy.
This is General.
Audio player.
Nightfall.
Crystal focus.
Nebula.
Grimmy. Grimmy.
You can use the activator as well to go backward to select the font quicker.
Off. Revolt.
Shattered voice. The force unleashed through. Coming home. The old republic. The old
Shoto. Youngling.
The balance.
So it boots again, and then you get with the. You get with the default behavior of the board. Now you're ready to fire up. So what I wanted to show now is so we saw the screensavers that are triggered, I think, after 10 seconds if something is displayed on the OLED. This avoids to burn the OLED if you have a static image waiting for too long. So what we have then, we have a PLI, same thing, the PLI and all the sprites are configurable. I will demonstrate more of those. I have, I think, at least five that are presented on the SD card and that are pre-made, and basically the user can just select them by renaming the file before using it. Then we have the font we're on. And also what I wanted to say, if the font picture is not present on the screen, you see you have another screensaver. We're going to review those after. There are four different screensavers available. So basically, if the picture is not there on the SD card, you will get the number, the font number, and the name of the font, the name of the path on the SD card displayed, so that you can at least see which font you're in. We have the firmware version. In the middle, you have that custom string that is displayed, which is configurable on the SD card as well. So basically, if you want the thing to display whatever you want, Vader's best saber or whatever, you can have this displayed here. You have a fair amount of characters to display those. We have a spinning crystal, and this is actually a real 3D file which is loaded dynamically from the SD card. So basically, you can have your own spinning shape displayed on the OLED. And this one is great. Then we have a bunch of animations. Those are, I won't say placeholders, because we definitely want them to stay. They are just played in sequence, one after the other. We haven't decided totally yet what to, not what to do with them, but if we make them configurable, or if we do some kind of configuration. Or if we let them just play like this, there is a sort of atom scanner, Geiger counter displayed. You have flying objects as a screensaver as well. Then you have that small oscilloscope that moves in real time. Obviously, the board can still function normally. You have tracks playing back in the backward. And then you have that VU meter. Rob from Genesis Custom Sabers wanted that. I think it's quite cool. Sorry about the screensavers. I configured them so that they can actually show up after a short time for the demonstration, but obviously you don't want that to appear too often. And finally, because the board has been configured to have it, I'm going to cut the music with a double click. We have a midichlorian scanner. It's displayed in very small, and basically it will sense the magnetic activity until you trigger. So this is what I demonstrated in the previous video, and I wanted to have something displayed on the OLED screen as well. I think it's both cool and it's a very convenient way to set up your threshold so that you don't even have to think about connecting the board and logging the messages, checking if your threshold is too low, too high, whatever. I wanted to say regarding the magnetic activation that there is a fully automated process to set up the reference field and the proximity sensing. For now, it's not available in the menu, but we have a full-blown menu with different layers instead of the global vocal menu that you know already. And this will have hooks to trigger pretty much what you want, and all the parameters of the board will be, well, a lot of the parameters of the board will be available from the vocal menu as well. So here you can see how it behaves, and if you are close enough, this makes it easier to adjust your threshold. So let's have a quick look to the screensavers. That are going to trigger eventually. You saw most of them so far. So you have the flying objects. They are randomly selected after 10 seconds, which is the value configured here. Like I said, the bitmap, the flying toast, is of course a very funny joke for some of us. You can use pretty much the bitmap you want. You just draw the bitmap of your choice on the SD card. So I'm going to reset that and maybe show the crystal again, the spinning crystal, and wait for the next. There you go. So you have at least one chase, good guy versus bad guy type of screensaver. I'm going to demonstrate a variant of that. We already have it on the SD card. It's just that the default is the Pac-Man one, because I thought it would be funny to do. And you have the ghost chasing the Pac-Man, and conversely. I will show later what else we have. I'm going to eventually wait for another one to show the bouncing logo. The bouncing logo is very simple, but pretty fun. Well, okay, that's the R2 again. I will eventually show the bouncing logo another time. So I'm back with new settings. I just paused the video and changed a few settings on the SD card to show you a different screensaver and also different PLI. So we have here a different PLI that was directly inspired by Slot Furnace, Brad climb card that he created. Oh, there you go. We have the good guy versus bad guy showing up. I like that one a lot. So we have a Stormtrooper and the R2 fighting and chasing. And the R2 is kicking back on the other side. That's pretty fun and great screensavers. So yeah, I was saying the PLI was created. We have a different crystal spinning. Those are actually generated by the firmware if they don't find a 3D file on the SD card. And so Brad designed that wonderful PCB clamp card recently, and he showed that on Facebook, so I asked for the permission to model this in the OLED. And same thing, it's just a picture that is stored on the SD card that you can edit and make your own. Even the small bars can be configured. As you can see, those are custom, and you have the full bar, the empty bar, and the background that are configurable. So the SD card actually comes with those already installed, and all you have to do is just select the one you want to use and rename them accordingly. I also wanted to demonstrate some of the close details of the interaction between the color profile selection and the display, because it's very cool to have all the information displayed in real time on the OLED. It's such a pretty cool thing to have. So we're going to start the saver, and then we have the profile, color profile, and body profile that we're using. We can move to another profile, and we have that neat animation in real time telling you which profile we've selected. The duration of the sound has been the duration of the fade, sorry, has been set to extra long to generate a very dramatic fade between the colors, so the sound is extra long, and so is the duration of the fade. Sorry, trigger the blaster, and there you go. You can go also into the blade menu. I'm going to save that profile, for instance. Power again, and we get into the spectrum menu. Then I can select the color I want. For instance, we go back to red, select it. Then again, and I get, for instance, a sort of purple. Long press, I get into blade profile. I have five blade profiles, five blade profiles, I think, currently. So I can select the one I want, or so it's profile one, and validate, and then I have my profile selected. So there you go, this is what you can get also on the display in real time, in addition of the animations that you've seen so far. You can get also some information about which color profile and blade profile you select, either by spectrum or with the profile browsing system, using the combination of switches or using the rotation of the hilt. Having that on the display is obviously very convenient to know exactly which one you select.